Good afternoon, and welcome to the theology faculty, theology of religion faculty of the University of Oxford. My name is Andrew Pinsent. I'm research director of the Ian Ramsey Centre. On behalf of the Centre, I'd like to welcome you and also like to welcome our colleagues at the University of Warsaw Philosophy Faculty who are joining us for this afternoon's event. We're very grateful to them also for their co-sponsorship of this event. So before we go any further, I'd like to just ask you to show your appreciation by clapping our colleagues at the University of Warsaw. I'd like to pass over to Mikolaj, who's going to introduce today's speaker.
Thank you very much, Andrew. So good afternoon. My name is Mikolaj Slawkowski-Rode, and I would like to welcome you to this first in this year's series of the Ian Ramsey Centre Humane Philosophy Project seminars, which are organized collaboratively, as Andrew said, with the Institute of Philosophy of the University of Warsaw, which is my alma mater, and in particular, the Department of the Philosophy of Culture, which I have been affiliated with continually since the beginning of my master's degree. So just a short point, which I might be repeating, Andrew, but just to make it very, very clear, that if you're unhappy with anything that that you've said during the Q&A, we'll be able to edit it out. However, since this is a live transmission, which is going to be received at Warsaw, whatever you say, our audience in Warsaw is going to receive as well. So just keep that in mind. So the theme of this series this year is the challenges of naturalism, which refers both to the challenges that naturalism poses and the challenges that naturalism faces. And it is my great pleasure and honor to introduce our first speaker of the series this year, Dr. Mary Midgley. So Mary Midgley is one of the United Kingdom's most widely read philosophers. Throughout much of her career, she was affiliated with the University of Newcastle, where she is now an Honorary Fellow of the Policy, Ethics, and Life Sciences Research Center. In 1995, she's been awarded an Honorary D.Litt at Durham University and an Honorary Doctor of Civil Law by Newcastle University in 2008. She has published 17 books examining a wide range of topics across philosophy, in particular philosophy of science, moral philosophy, and animal rights. She is perhaps best known for her ongoing research of reductionism and scientism, which spanned numerous academic textbooks and articles. And her publications include the 1978 Beast and Man, her 1981 Wickedness, or am I getting it in the wrong order?
I don't know.
Well, also Heart and Mind and Science and Poetry. From her many titles, this is a very subjective selection because these books by Mary Midgley, I personally have read and have in my library and therefore can full-heartedly recommend for anyone's reading and education in philosophy. And today Mary Midgley is going to speak about science, scientism, and the self. So please give a very warm welcome to our first speaker of this year's series of Humane Philosophy and Ramsey Centre seminars.
Well, thank you. And I have to start by saying how impressed I am to find that I'm talking to the University of Warsaw, a pleasure that I have not had before, and I hope they'll enjoy it. I should apologize because I can't stand. I would greatly prefer to be doing a Cicero, but I can't. And I'm delighted to find that the Blackfriars, which I used to know many years ago, is still in business, although it's moved into a hospital, which I find rather odd, and that it's advertising humane philosophy. That is something we very much need to do today, and I can see that you're doing it properly. Well, so scientism and the self. Most societies center their lives around certain characteristic beliefs. Some take these beliefs literally and express them directly in action. But for others, the beliefs are rather an imaginative or symbolic importance. Thus, if we ask about Christian attitudes to war and conquest, we find quite a complicated situation. On the one hand, Christ himself said plainly that his kingdom was not of this world, and he forbade his followers to fight for him. But when Christian churches began to get political power, the people running them were involved in conflicts with opponents whom they saw as God's enemies and were often quite willing to engage in ordinary war against them. What made this shift into real life easier was the extraordinary power of the human imagination, and that is what I'm chiefly talking about today. Lively symbolism had already envisaged inner conflict as a form of warfare. Thus, St. Paul readily encouraged people to fight the good fight of faith. And when Constantine adopted Christianity as the official religion of the Roman Empire, the military idea of order, which had always ruled Roman life, latched on very readily to the new ideals, using language which shifted constantly between a symbolic and a literal meaning, so that holy wars were conducted frequently. These shifts have been particularly marked in the poetic language of hymns and psalms, where they're still active today. Thus, peaceable 19th century citizens weren't at all surprised to find themselves singing Onward Christian Soldiers, or even more excitingly, The Son of God goes forth to war, a kingly crown to gain. His blood-red banner streams afar, who follows in his train? So on. People knew, of course, that this language was metaphorical. But in the turbid waters of our imagination, these different levels of meaning don't remain distinct. It's an important part of my theme today to notice how far the dreams, the visions, the myths that surround our official beliefs can carry us into areas where we really didn't think of going when we started. And when, for instance, actual wars are going on in the world, the application of these images can become extremely confusing. My father, in 1916, was a young chaplain, and he was sent to the front, which he was quite prepared to go, but he was astonished and appalled to find that what he had to do was to explain to men who were dying just why they were dying. This was an experience which very deeply influenced his life and left him centering his political life on trying to stop wars. But you see, the difference between the reality and the hymns is something that people really don't notice a lot of the time. Now, what I've said so far is, of course, a familiar part of history. We know about the shift between fantasy and reality, and we know that it's not just hypocrisy. It's a part of the normal working of our imagination to have a picture on one side and a life on the other and keep them separate. What I want to say next, however, is not so familiar. I want to point out that physical science for many years now succeeded to the position of authority in our culture, which used to be held by religious doctrine. It's regarded as something that has to be believed. And this shift has disturbing effects on the way in which we now think about science itself. Instead of seeing physical sciences as real but limited sources of knowledge about material facts, we are now called upon to reveal them as the source of all our knowledge. Science fiction helps this confusion and can add great emotional force to it. science does not then appear just as one star among many, but as a kind of sun, the final form of knowledge, the destined end product of all learning, a terminus for which all other kinds of thought are just provisional sketches. This is the vision of science now on offer. It is the creed of scientism. If you doubt that such a creed exists, let's look at a recent manifesto for it, issued by Professor Lawrence Krauss, cosmologist and professor of physics at Arizona State University. First, Krauss gets rid of philosophy. One, all questions of philosophy are either meaningless or can be answered by science. Two, philosophers are no use to scientists. And by getting rid of philosophy, he has, of course, got rid of any system that might show science as just one way of thinking among others, because all such systems are philosophical. Next, he explains why science reigns supreme like this. Three, science has authority because it is based on physical evidence. Scientific claims will therefore always overrule philosophical claims. He thinks that's obvious. And finally, he summed up the ruling position at which it's now arrived for. Science provides the ultimate account of the basis of reality, the ultimate metaphysics. But it substantively changes the questions, getting to the correct ones rather than the meaningless philosopher's ones. Well, shortly after this, the Higgs boson was very much in the news, and the magazine New Scientist had on its cover the following notice: "Forget the Higgs, now we're searching for the root of reality." You see, they were using this language too. Krauss's first two claims seemed to clash rather sharply with his last one. Science, it seems, rules that philosophy is not needed, but it can apparently now start philosophizing on its own. Science provides the ultimate account of the basis of reality, the ultimate metaphysic. We might ask how it can do this when it's also claiming, three, that its authority is always based on physical evidence. Ultimate accounts of the basis of reality would surely have to apply to reality as a whole. They couldn't rest on particular physical facts. So what is going on here? As so often happens, we need to look directly at the underlying feud, the ongoing dispute that has brought this matter to the surface. That dispute is really about whether reality is essentially made of mind or matter, or, in short, which is the top discipline, science or the humanities? This question certainly can't be settled by any particular physical facts, nor, of course, by mental ones. It's a real philosophical question, so it needs to be dealt with, like all such questions, by getting a better understanding of what is at issue. For this, we have to ask first, why are these two things, mind and matter, being set in competition in the first place? We're not, you see, just asking what the objects around us are made of in the everyday sense. That would be a real physical question, quite properly answered by physical science. But our question now is rather how best to understand the things that puzzle us in human life. For instance, warfare, depression, sport, obsessiveness, sex, mortality, and so forth. And here, physical science is of no immediate help to us. It simply isn't relevant. Scientism, however, insists that these sciences will become relevant quite shortly. In fact, the sciences will be relevant as soon as they have finished their current research programs. Thus, E.O. Wilson, in the rousing conclusion of his monumental tome, Sociobiology, 1975, explained how the sociology of the future would be able to deal scientifically with topics which now seem to involve human thoughts and feelings. by reducing these to their underlying brain mechanisms. This new enlightenment, said Wilson, must await a full neuronal explanation of the human brain. Only when the machinery can be torn down on paper at the level of the cell and put together again will the properties of emotion and ethical judgment come clearer. I'm not quite sure how that metaphor's supposed to work, but never mind. Stress will be evaluated in terms of the underlying perturbations and their relaxation times. Cognition will be translated into circuitry. Learning and creativeness will be defined as the alteration of specific portions of the cognitive machinery regulated by input from the emotive centers. Having cannibalized psychology, the neurobiology will yield an enduring set of first principles for sociology. Wave the flag. Wilson doesn't talk like this today at all. Quite different. However, he made this generous offer in 1975, which was actually something of a high tide moment for scientism. It was all the fashion then, as it was also for science fiction. At that time, claims that Wilson, the kind that Wilson made, were heard on all sides, and they naturally produced the obvious response, okay, go ahead and do it. You see, they kept saying, we can, we will. An attentive audience awaited results, but these haven't been very encouraging. It soon became clear that you can't actually evaluate stress simply in terms of the underlying perturbations and their reaction times. Because evaluating is a distinct kind of job calling for a quite different conceptual scheme. Nor can we settle all the questions that arise about learning and creativeness simply by defining these things as alterations in the cognitive machinery. It was very fashionable then, it still goes on now, but it makes no sense. Brain research has indeed intensified, and we know, and it's increasingly busy today, but it still hasn't managed to explain how to relate the realms of mind and matter. In fact, this whole reductive program, this mindless materialism, this belief in something called matter as the answer to all questions, is not really science at all. As Karl Popper said, it is promissory materialism. It's a promise to do with something which doesn't get done. Karl Popper. Sorry, yes. This is an offer of future explanations based on boundless confidence in physical methods of inquiry to do anything. It's a quite general belief in matter, which is conceived in a new way as able to answer all possible questions. And that belief has flowed much more from the past glories of science than from any suitability for the job in hand. Not all questions are physical questions or can be usefully fitted to physical answers. That attempt to use physical terms everywhere is one of many bad ways out of the problem of dualism, the difficulty of treating the world as divided into mind and matter in the first place. As if these were simply two parallel materials like iron and nickel or something. So that we would only have to decide which of them is the more fundamental. This conception of a twofold world is really an outdated muddle. It arose in the 16th century because there were then only two sophisticated ways of thinking, essentially physics on the one hand and theology with its doctrines about the fate of the human soul on the other, available to inquiries, and there was no obvious way of relating them. So Descartes decided, and if he hadn't, somebody else certainly would have done, that theological and psychological thinking applied to the world of the mind, while physics dealt with the world of matter, so things could be kept apart. The only link between the two was that both were the work of God. As Newton put it, nature and revelation were God's two books, which he had given us to study. Both were important, but at the deepest level, theology trumped physics because God was the author of both. And for a century or two, most people, including most scientists, were quite satisfied with this. Since that time, however, the scene has been totally transformed. First, the physical sciences themselves have branched out into a galaxy of different methods, quite unlike the highly abstract physics of Renaissance times. Methods suited for particular different kinds of subject matter. The people who today write earnest books saying that we ought to stick to science usually mean physics and the physics of that date rather than the present day. And a whole set of other galaxies of different studies have developed round them to deal with other kinds of topics. Historical methods have grown up for dealing with the past. This was something simply wasn't on the agenda in the 16th, 15th century. Historical methods have grown up and linguistic methods for dealing with language. And plenty of meta methods, philosophical methods for dealing with the relations between these different kinds of thinking. Perhaps most disturbingly too, the social sciences have arisen to deal with matters nearer home, ways of asking about the complexities of human life. In short, it's become clear that there aren't two separate kinds of stuff at all. Mind is what we see if we look at the world from one point of view, through one kind of lens, asking one kind of question. And matter is what we see if we look at it through quite a different lens, asking different questions. One view shows us subjects, the other objects. One shows the inner world, the other the outer one. But both aspects are showing us the same world. This is the difficult work. Yes, understanding the relation between these two is the difficult work which the social sciences have taken on. And we know that though they sometimes get things wrong, their work is necessary. But the prophets of scientism find this whole suggestion that there can be such a thing as a non-physical science extremely shocking. Thus, Lewis Wolpert shows a real horror at the whole idea of sociology. He writes, "In a sense, all science aspires to be like physics, and physics itself aspires to be like mathematics. In spite of recent successes, biology has a long way to go when measured against physics or chemistry. But sociology, what hope is there for sociology acquiring a physics-like luster?" This plaintive cry of physics envy shows how far scientific reality has moved away from scientific dreams. Wolpert is himself a distinguished embryologist, so he knows quite well that his own science couldn't possibly be reshaped to resemble physics. How would one do that? And it doesn't need to be. Embryology is about embryos. It's not meant like physics to deal with every kind of physical matter. It's not in competition. So it uses forms that suit its particular topic, and so does every other special branch of science. Those branches don't have to be unified or reduced to something else. They can be used side by side. But still that dream persists of a single ideal scientific method, the scientific method, a universal super study that could really explain everything. And Wolpert's notion that, in a sense, all science aspires to be like physics shows how physics itself has now been elected to that sublime position. He is, of course, quoting Walter Pater's remark that all the arts aspire to the condition of music, which just means that they must not be distracted from their central aim by the oddities of particular subject matters. So it doesn't happen to music. that the idea that physics itself aspires to be like mathematics suggests something much more extreme, doesn't it? It suggests that sciences ought to have no subject matter at all and that physics can eventually live without one. Now, I'm afraid that really won't do. Physics is not like mathematics, a purely formal study. It gives us real information about the world, this world. But it never pretends to tell us the whole truth about that or anything else. Like every particular science, physics too is a partial story, an abstraction, a view seen through a single window, a set of photos taken from one particular position. In order to use it, we always need to put it together with the other sciences and with a great mass of informal knowledge, which counts as common sense. It could never be the ruling center of our thoughts. In fact, of course, physics itself never makes Crisis claim to supply the ultimate metaphysic, the ultimate account of the basis of reality. Don't know why he thinks metaphysics is a separate word from physics, but it is. So why should anyone ever have expected physical science to do that? This hope surely flowed from the history that I've just mentioned, the long-standing clash between two metaphysics and the rivalry that inevitably developed between their sponsors. Which method, which profession, which vision of life ought we to back? Essentially, this was an issue about where we, what we put our trust in, what we think is most crucial. Traditional trust in the theological account was gradually weakened by the wars of religion, which gave it bad political associations and also raised questions about what it really meant. Meanwhile, Newton developed the physical story in a clear, simple form, making it look quite plausible that, as Pope put it, God said, let Newton be, and all was light. For a time, both stories accepted together. But as the physical story grew increasingly dominant in ordinary thought, some people aspired to tidy up metaphysics by getting rid of the mental story altogether. Materialists such as Marx evolved quite subtle devices for doing this. But it was hard to do it, you see, without losing the mind's more obvious product, such as science itself. Lately, however, mind haters have grown too impatient to bother with these subtleties, so they now attack the problem with a meat axe, declaring that mind itself simply doesn't exist. All that really exists, it seems, is physical matter. Thus, Francis Crick, Mr. DNA in person, kindly shares with us what he calls his astonishing hypothesis, which is that, and I quote, "You, your joys and your sorrows, your memories and your ambitions, your sense of personal identity and free will are in fact no more than the behaviour of a vast assembly of nerve cells and their associated molecules." To state this idea in stronger terms, the scientific belief is that our minds, the behaviour of our brains, can be explained by the interaction of nerve cells and other cells and the molecules associated with them. The sense of self is then no more than an illusion. Nothing is real except the brain cells. This view is now put forward quite widely as being the official message of science. I shan't say much about that campaign now because I've lately written a whole book, Are You an Illusion?, inquiring what on earth this suggestion could possibly mean. And asking in particular just who it is that is supposed to be having the illusion. But perhaps we should now ask an even more radical question. If we have no minds, where did we get all this scientific knowledge, which we apparently have? How do we know so much about things like brain cells? If our minds are and have always been mere empty jugs conveying pure illusion. For instance, Crick claims, you see, to have got rid of our memories and our ambitions, But how could people who never remembered anything or formed any projects think scientifically? Science is, after all, a product of minds. It's simply one way of thinking, among a welter of other ways that we all use. It's not a magic cure-all that can bypass all our other faculties. It's just one more set of tools, quite recently added to humanity's enormous toolkit, to do a particular range of jobs. Why should anybody think that it would give us a shortcut to the whole of reality? This idea does indeed seem so improbable that you may well begin to think that I've made it up. Can it actually be true that reputable scientists are taking such an indefensible line? Well, I'm afraid that it can, and this happens because of something which I mentioned right at the beginning, the immense power of the human imagination. They are looking at symbols and not at reality. Symbols, images, visions are indeed the scene of all our most serious thinking, and what goes on underneath and starts it. They are where real thought goes on, and the sketchy summaries of thought that we eventually formulate as academic subjects, such as the scientists, are only their shadows. When these ideas are successful, we call them intuitions and treat them with great respect. But the trouble is that when these visions represent an idea in sublime and violent colours, our reasoning sometimes finds it impossible to resist them. And during that crucial epoch when modern science was dawning, the dominant symbol that shaped all speculation about it was the vision of something that was then quite new, machinery, essentially clockwork. Clocks and automata were the miracle of the age. In a startling manner, the universe began to appear as a vast clock, and everything within it as a cog or a wheel in that clock's mechanism. I know machines have changed, but that imagery is still with us. It's no wonder that learned people were dazzled by that tremendous image. They were deeply and understandably impressed, perhaps traumatized by the sudden appearance of automata, the skillfully devised clockwork figures of men and animals, which act as if they were living beings. Have you ever seen the silver swan? Silver swan. It's the way they do the water. It looks completely convincing somehow, and it reaches down and picks up a fish and swallows. Swallows it. Real swans don't swallow fish, but this one does. If one didn't know as much as we now know about these things, it's no surprise this seemed real magic. That experience was surely what made Descartes find it plausible to say that actual animals were really automata too. Physical items wound up to react in a lifelike manner without any real feeling at all. That vision of them still persists to an astonishing extent. There are plenty of theorists today who think reason calls upon them to assume that animals are not conscious. They consider this proposition that animals are conscious as something from outside that, you know, wouldn't be there, and is probably wrong. And as time went on, this imagery was gradually spread to form an explanation for the whole of life. It was all a lot of clockwork that had been wound up, an explanation that seemed to make mind completely unnecessary. One interesting thing here is that nobody seems to have seen that this mechanistic vision was unworkable. Real, literal machines don't emerge into the world like this at all. They don't grow on trees, do they? Somebody always has to invent them. In fact, they are essentially products of living minds, devices framed to fulfill some particular human purpose. If you want to understand them, you have to find what that purpose is. Machine imagery may often be useful, but it is not a way of getting rid of teleology, explanation by purpose, from our understanding of the natural world. In fact, it only makes that teleology more explicit. This is another thing that I keep coming across in scientific literature. People are talking of teleology as something rather disgusting, which has now been got rid of, and they're using it all the time, so we have to. It is odd to see how confidently people ignore this fact, how readily they use machine talk to get rid of explanation by conscious purpose. An example of this casualness, which particularly surprised me, comes from John Searle, usually a very shrewd and careful discriminator between metaphor and literal language. Asking whether artificial intelligence is possible, Searle sets up the following brief dialogue. Could a machine think? The answer is obviously yes. We are precisely such machines. Yes, but could a man-made machine think? And he goes on to argue the point as if some machines were not man-made. But all this is surely only metaphor leading to empty conclusions. I am coming to the end. What seems to be happening here is that machine imagery has somehow worked its way into our thinking on these subjects in very much the same way as battle imagery worked its way into Christian thinking, and the imagery of selfishness has worked its way into modern talk about genetics. Machine imagery has become so habitual, indeed so automatic, that people hardly notice it, let alone criticize it or see it as dangerous. When we come across something interesting going on in the natural world, our academic superego tells us to look for the mechanism that makes this happen. That, we feel, will be the real explanation behind the mere surface phenomena. By contrast, the organic growth, the spontaneity, the life that we directly perceive is just something provisional, which may turn out to be a mistake. Bernard Shaw often talked about the life force, and I think what he said about the life force was often perfectly sensible. This is quite a reasonable term to use, but nobody could use it today. In this way, familiar visions, well-known and powerful images, come to take the place of the plain facts before us. This is what I meant when I said at the outset that the human imagination has far more power than we realize. We don't think that we are making things up, but we are. Of course, that imagination also has great power for good. It gives us our new visions, new insights, new development. But if we're anxious to, which are the source of all our fresh ideas and inventions, but if we don't want these newer developments, if we are anxious to resist change, imagination also provides us with an escape hatch by going somewhere different. In strengthening our resistance, it plainly often has power to set aside any regular process of argument. This is why people who are in the grip of a favored vision often seem to be quite immune to regular argument. And it's why that favored vision is often rather a primitive, infantile one. Thus, battle imagery has an obvious primitive appeal. And the childish emotive image of a nanny state is enough to stop many people paying attention to the hard facts of climate change. Similarly, seeing the living world as simply a lifeless mass of machinery shows that world as something alien and passive, something without value in itself, something that is entirely under our control. Mechanism, in fact, is essentially a power fantasy, and that is surely one good reason for distrusting it. So the general point emerging here is we need to be far more aware than we are of what our imaginations are up to, have a better grasp of the visions to which they move us than we now have.
questions. I'm coming to ask to say there's a car block in the exit, I'm afraid. And if this is your car registration number, please would you move your car? 4768NLK. And whoever it is, put a note saying they're coming to this seminar. So
would be A76.
Maybe A76. I don't know, NLK, something like that. There's someone parked outside with a note. Could you please move your car?
I think we found.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much, Dr. Midgley, for a really rich talk. And it's always wonderful to have a speaker who can use terms that no one can use today. So we do have plenty of time for some questions. I think what we'll do, I know that Jonathan Price at the front has a question, and after he's asked his, I'm going to ask him to hand the mic around to further questions. And if you have a question, please just wait until the mic's got to you so that it will be audible to everyone here and also so that it will be on our recording as well. I'd also add that I know that Mikolaj might be receiving by telepathy some questions from the University of Warsaw audience, which we're very keen to take as well. So.
Thank you for the talk, Professor Midgley. I had a question about the imagination and about the analogies here, because what I tend to hear is computer-based analogies nowadays for the functioning of the mind or the functioning of many of scientific explanations in terms of hardware, software, things of that sort. But those are a bit dated as well. Computers are getting smaller, they're getting more and more opaque in a way. The technology is more opaque to normal people. So now we have a phone, it does all kinds of things that we could never imagine it doing. We don't know how it works, so we call it smart. Yeah? So we call it a smartphone, yeah. I wonder what you, if you could think or answer, what you think could happen when the technology becomes opaque to us so that the metaphors don't quite work anymore. Where does science go? Where does the imagination go when it can't reach the functions?
Yes, well, I've been reading various speculations about that. And it seems John von Neumann said that quite shortly, machines will become unintelligible to people because, it has all gone too far. That is obviously an alarming and distressing thought because we're very dependent on machines in lots of ways. I'm not sure what, as it was, the central question to deal with here. I mean, the chief thing, well, I mean, the first thing you're doing is drawing attention to the vision of computers, when people turn to when they wonder, why is somebody thinking like this? Instead of looking to their motives and their worldview, they'll say, well, I think it's the this or that, you see, the machinery in there, which is a great distraction. I think we are very confused at present, and I'm not sure how, as it were, in one answer to this, I can do much about it. But I mean, you see, one piece of imagery that's very active among people who are into computers and so on at present is called the singularity. About the singularity, this is the moment that's coming when computers get more clever than people. And it is looked at in two ways. One is the cheerful way that, of course, then they'll, as it were, feed it all into us and we can really maybe unite to the computers. The computers will become united to us. The gloomy view, which John von Neumann was obviously taking, was we've reached the point where human life can't be understood. Well, I think one has to resist the dramas and look at the details of what's going on and see what it amounts to. I think the temptation to over emphasize these pictures is a dangerous one. It's united with part of what I'm saying about our imaginations need towards them. I don't know in what sense these people who talk and write about the singularity actually believe in it. I mean, they ought to be extremely frightened because they obviously don't know what it's supposed to amount to. But I mean, the first thing to say to is that there's something potty about this setting of the computers up in competition against people as if they're learning the same thing and they've got ahead of us. Well, they are tools which people use, and it's the people, not the tools, that are the menace. And one way in which this singularity is imagined is that they will simply take over the human race. They'll start running everything. Well, they aren't able to do that. They're not the kind of item that could. They're not agents. You know, this is a superstition. am I making things difficult?
No, not at all. I'm just, I fear that my question's going to end up...
I don't know how far to go on this large...
Well, as long as you like. I mean, don't let Jonathan stop.
No, I'll start looking.
Well, we should... Let's move on, because I know there are plenty of questions here. What about the lady?
Well, if we are rejecting the sort of mechanical way of describing the mind, the self, through that type of metaphors that you sort of criticized, what is your preferred metaphor to describe the mind, to actually approach the topic of the mind? Where shall we base that type of metaphor?
Well, I suppose we use metaphors as we need them to illustrate particular points, don't we? I did say that the mind is not a thing on its own. It's what you see. It is, you know, there's this mental aspect of the world. So if you're thinking about thoughts and people's thoughts and feelings, or the animals' thoughts and feelings, you concentrate on those. But it's the people and the animals are still the items that are out there in the world. There isn't one thing called mind, which has particular way of working, and it particularly isn't a machine.
So we have to admit that perhaps the mind is a construct, again like a metaphor to make it easy for us to conceptualize, to somehow talk about it, rather than a phenomenon that can be eventually dissected.
That's all right. When you talk about a construct, it begins to sound again as if it was a particular thing that we've constructed. It's one aspect. Suppose you're dealing with a particular bunch of people, trying to understand them. At one time, you think, well, what are they thinking? And you try to find out all about what they're thinking. At another time, you think, well, have they got weapons, you see, or something physical about them? Then you're dealing with the physical, material world. But you don't think of their bodies as particular items which are going to do this or that, because you are looking at the whole physical situation. I suppose that's what I'm saying, that people's bodies are a construct. I suppose so, because for medical purposes, you move into a particular point of view to think about somebody's physique or their health. If you think about somebody's health, that's one way of thinking about them. If you think about that, you see, you might also be interested in their ideas. You move to start talking about their ideas. You more or less move to a different position and start looking in from a different angle. It's not that you have found an item which wasn't there before. It's that you're thinking. You're asking different questions, attending to different aspects. I'm not quite sure what is involved in saying it's a construct, but it's the sort of thing that bothers me. Yeah.
So I gather we've got a question right at the back of the room.
Yes.
From Dr. Phil Walden.
You will have to shout.
You might have to shout.
Thank you, Professor Midgley, for a very stimulating talk. I just wanted to pick up on your point about Karl Marx, because you said, you suggested that Marx had tried to tidy up metaphysics by removing the mind story. I think that the way I would put it is that Marx, in his early life, was very interested in philosophical anthropology and was very interested in questions about how human beings could lead a good life and how they should behave towards each other. But as he started to try to understand the capitalist economy, those questions in part receded and he may have become a little bit positivist, a little bit too reliant on a scientific way of approaching the world. So the question I'd like to put to you is, do you feel that any thinker in the past has really found a balance, the right balance between the kinds of questions that the early Marx was thinking about and the kind of questions that the later Marx was thinking
about?
Well,
thank you. I certainly didn't want to suggest that Marx was trying to get rid of these mental questions. But, I mean, the word materialism remained central, didn't it, to what he... Yes. So he presumably always wanted in some way to get rid of the idea of the existing soul as a separate thing, didn't he? I don't know the details of this, but he wanted to, what's perfectly reasonable, to explain a person as a whole, including their body, and he wanted very much to give the bodies their just share, as it were. Dialectical materialism, that's the term, isn't it? So obviously the argument's going on all the time. There's progress in dialectical materialism. You're finding out more and more. I just wanted to contrast him with this entirely crude materialism. Now I've told you materialism, which is so fashionable today. And I would certainly wanted to emphasize that he got quite very interested in these questions. So thank you.
Just to follow up on that. So Phil's last question was whether any historical philosopher...
Sorry?
Whether any historical philosopher has gotten the balance right between the material side and the human side.
Well,
I'd be interested to know.
Since this division got into our thought, nobody's got it right. I don't wish to be unappreciative of people's efforts, but it has always been mixed up, you see, with these moral feuds, hasn't it? That the spirit's good and first the spirit was good and the body was bad, and then the body was good and the spirit was a nuisance. H. Lawrence on. No, I think it's a European philosophy, at least, has been tangled around this. Whether the Buddhists do any better, I couldn't tell you.
Our next question.
I'm delighted, as always, with your analysis. Do you think that modern scientific naturalism really thinks that the human mind is part of nature?
Well, you see, I think modern scientific naturalism is in a terrible muddle about this because they haven't put that for themselves. But the tendency of an awful lot of the propaganda that we get about the importance of cutting up brain cells and so on, certainly does suggest that there isn't anything else. And now I suppose I just trying to think about the history of this. In 19th century, materialism was seen on the whole as a campaign against the church. So it was often taken up by people who wanted to get the soul out of some argument or other, for various reasons that they thought it was superstitious. Because of this feud in the background, feud between the church and those who had thought the church was dangerous, there was a lot of trouble. T.H. Huxley was rather important in all this because he was trying with great splendor to get more money into scientific research than was there before. And of course, where the money was, a lot of it was in the church or in classics, which was also thought to be an enemy of the same kind. Huxley wasn't, as it were, a fierce atheist, but he was extremely anti-church, what is the word? keep getting think it's anti-Semitic, but it isn't. He thought the church was a really bad and dangerous institution, but not just the Catholic Church, any old church. So there was a lot of rather unbalanced metaphysical argument going on. People who appeared to be doing ontology, talking about what there actually is in reality, but were in fact conducting their private feuds. I haven't gone right back, but I said that the trouble, as it were, this sort of trouble popped up in the 16th century, and it only increased as the political wars between particular churches and particular other political causes got more and more fierce. People did not make great efforts to talk sensibly and balanced way about this. So I in this question, did anybody get it right? Some people got it much more right than others, but on the whole, they weren't so widely read, I think. Reading past philosophers, one sometimes finds rather splendid remarks in a particular case, but what caught the public attention, what always got into politics really, would be arguments which were very much yes and no, black and white. Oversimplifying it, so I think the record has been rather dismal.
So I think we have a question here, possibly all the way from Warsaw.
Yes, indeed, there's a question all the way from Warsaw by Agata Łukomska, which I'm very happy to say resonates with one of the talks given at a conference the Humane Philosophy, together with the Ian Ramsey Center and the Dalai Lama Center, put on at the end of September in Warsaw. And the talk was by Professor Jos de Moule from Erasmus University. And the question is, proponents of scientism, the mind haters, as it were, are in the grip of the machine image, what Jos de Moule would characterize as greedy materialists, aren't the people who are the matter haters, aren't they in the grip of something like a greedy transcendentalism? Don't they try to impose a similar sort of reductionism onto the condition that human beings are in as the opposing side?
Well, thank you. May I make another greeting to Warsaw in saying this? Yes, I mean, and this can be true both of, frankly, Christian or anyway religious writers, and also of what you might call New Age people. There's a sort of spiritualism which can be quite clear of any particular church, but is if they are moved by, as it were, party feeling, by this enjoyment of row with the opposition, then they are so far unbalanced. And I think it's true in both these parties that we aren't in Los Angeles, and it would be unfair to start talking about New Age theorizing, but some of it is obviously of that kind. I suppose one quite important thing here is when everybody emigrated to America, a great proportion of those who emigrated did so on religious grounds, didn't they? That they were some sort of Protestant who was in trouble at home. So America became rather full of rather pious Protestants who had their own crisis, and also of anti-Protestants, people who didn't like this kind of thing and wanted to get rid of it. So I think that there are all sorts of local warfares going on there, and because the state of America is very important to the state of everybody else in the West, I think this is probably quite important. The moral of it all seems to me that we have to try to avoid this sort of commitment fighting, you know, to avoid depending on the idea that we've got an enemy who has to be destroyed and got rid of, because it makes a mess of our thinking. And obviously, over time, conversions have gone on in all kinds of directions, haven't they? Conversions of the religious to religion and vice versa. And they have tended to go with the tribal shift that you now identify with a different group of people. And I think that really is the main trouble with all these subjects, that it's very hard to get talking about them without committing oneself to that sort of one-sidedness. And Graham, no.
I might have a short follow-up question, which isn't literally from Poland, but from a Pole. This is to tie on to Ralph's question about whether there's anybody in the recent history of philosophy who might have gotten the balance right. And so I suppose that something that's persuasive to me is the mid-20th century considerations that emerge from the phenomenological tradition. So someone like Merleau-Ponty, yes, who says, yes, that the mind-body division, yes, the spirit-matter division, yes, is actually rooted in something that is much more fundamental, mm-hmm, and that the primary phenomenon in the world to consider is the embodied subject. That's, mm-hmm, not something, mm-hmm, that is ultimately analyzable into, yes, these two separate paradigms, but that's something that these two paradigms are possible to extrapolate from. Yeah. And this is in line with something that John Cottingham says about Descartes himself. So his idea of trialism in Descartes is, as you obviously know, and this is very important to all of us here involved with the Humane Philosophy Project, because we take the name from John Cottingham's essay by that name. So his idea is that Descartes isn't a proponent of the ghost in the machine view. This is something that originates with Malebranche immediately after Descartes. Descartes sees the unity of mind and body as a separate third entity, which is also more basic than the two in our experience. And this is something that is the start of Husserl's analysis of the phenomenon as the basic thing. And that results in Merleau-Ponty's positing of the embodied subject as the fundamental interest of philosophy. So I wonder whether you see some sort of step forward being made in that tradition.
Yes, I quite agree. I think Merleau-Ponty is very good about this. And I was saying in this rather unhelpful, vague sort of way that I seem quite often to read, reading various people I find perfectly sensible, reconciliations. And yes, the difficulty for this is that the whole world of our thought is moving all the time, so that words are always changing, aren't they? But I think Merleau-Ponty is as good a guide for someone to follow about this as could be, yes.
A question back there in what I estimate is the eighth row. Gentleman in the blue shirt.
Formulating this as I speak, but what I think you're talking about is the problem we have as we perceive the world is that we try to reduce it to some conceptual scheme. And of course, when the conceptual scheme is not the world. And so when we've got the conceptual scheme, it matches the world in some respects. This is what you're calling a story or a myth. And then if we get stuck in the myth or the conceptual scheme, then of course, there's points when it doesn't match the world and we get stuck in a single conceptual scheme. This is what you're saying, isn't it? And this is what you're talking about is the need for everybody who has an academic subject or a way of understanding the world to engage in philosophy. Would that be a correct summary of one of the things you're saying?
Yes, indeed. we ought all to be brought up to be able to move away from these either-or paths which we are get stuck with. And I think this institution called Philosophy for Children does a rather good job about this, and it should be encouraged, and there should be more of it, that we all need to get used to the thought that there aren't just two opinions, the right and the wrong. There are all sorts of other directions in which one might go. See, the way they proceed with quite small children is to get them talking in pairs after having heard a story and see what they say. And nobody is ever told that their view is wrong. People express their different views, and these are sort of untangled and gone into. But it really does seem to get into people's heads quite early in life that there could be yet another way out of the difficulty that you're in, you see, and you haven't got to choose between two bad parties, which one tends to think. Yes, I think that philosophy is indeed what's being done in this situation and that it should be pretty useful.
I'd like to ask a quick question. I'm a former physicist myself, and a few years ago I went back to a certain very famous physics laboratory, and we had a meeting with the top scientists, and for half a day they were asking the question, what is truth? And they were very excited by this question. The only slightly disturbing thing was that they hadn't really heard the philosophical tradition and hadn't really engaged with this question much before. Yeah. So for people trained in a very scientific way, a very technical way today, as is true of many of our students, what would you recommend? Are there any particular texts or books that would be most helpful for starting to find other ways of thinking that would enrich their own thinking? Do you have any particular recommendations?
Other than the Urfro of Dr.
Of course.
I think it isn't really books, it's people. It is an essential part of this to talk with more than one person about this. And what people get from books depends on where they start, I suppose. It can often happen, I think, that people, without having noticed particularly what they thought before, find some philosopher useful because they are telling them something new. I've been struck sometimes by the number of people who seem to read Spinoza. They are obviously getting something, and I can sort of see what it might be. But what it is will depend on where they're starting from, won't it? So I don't think there's any, unfortunately, I don't think there's any general answer to this, but there are quite a lot of books that... Descartes is actually an awfully good way to start, I think. But you do have to get away from Descartes' quest for certainty. So you need some help in doing that.
Professor Midgley, I have a quick question about science fiction and imagination. I have a quick question about science fiction and imagination and literature. not only amongst scientists, but amongst many people whom I know that deal in the academy. They just don't have time for fiction, they say, right? They're non-literary or literature animals. And I wonder, you mentioned how pernicious an effect on the more corrupt forms of imagination science fiction has had. Do you see a role for literature in the arts as a corrective and a reality that can stand against the imagination that's present within scientism?
Well, I think that reading a reasonable spread of books can be very corrective. But what, of course, can happen with the people you mention is they don't believe in fiction in general, but they are continually reading spy stories or detective stories, you know, which are all in the same sort of twist. And I was trying to think this, yes, I mean, the women's magazine stories, you know, go round, 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 same one. So I suppose the thing about literature is that you hope to get a chance to read several things, but it is surprising how much sometimes a particular novel will do for everybody. I keep noticing this in reading reviews of biographies of people, how somebody's novels have been a tremendous service to somebody, and you wouldn't have thought about it, you know, but there was a gap on that side of their life, I suppose. So I think all one can say is read a very varied selection of novels. And I mean, if you can't read novels at all, you're really in trouble, I think.
Are there more questions? You can have a second if you want. I took one. Be a little... Ralph.
Thank you. So I just wanted to ask a question related to the topic of reductionism. So you mentioned at one point embryology as an area of special science and asked how on earth would you reduce embryology to physics?
Yeah.
Now, it seems to me, so as far as I understand, and I'm reasonably illiterate in this area, but as far as I understand, some areas of biology can be reduced to, for instance, chemistry, or even as far as elements of particle physics, insofar as you can say, if this particular process in molecular biology, for instance, happens, then this particular macroscopic process has to happen as well. If you get one, then you just will get the other, which seems a bit like a reduction. And so it seems to me, if that's the case, which might be wrong, presumably this will happen in certain areas in embryology. So what I want to ask is, well, partly, is your view that all reductionist analyses of that kind are to be rejected, or merely a spirit of reductionism that wants to do this to absolutely everything? And also, a slightly connected question, whether in embryology, as far as I'm aware, as a scientific discipline, embryology doesn't deal with lots of questions which people do ask about embryos. You know, are they persons? Are they potential persons? What does this mean morally and so forth? So hasn't some of the reductionism already been done?
Yes. The Vienna Circle took strongly the view that all science could be reduced to physics. I don't know how they can have made this look in the least plausible, because while it's perfectly true that physical questions pop up in every physical material science, you've got to know an awful lot of the background before it'll make any sense to you. I mean, suppose you'd never seen a baby, you see, or come across any instance of embryos, you couldn't start. And it's the first stages of any science are observing this particular kind of thing, and then you know, it's a tree or whatever, you've got to experience a lot of trees in order to have the idea of what tree is at all, and to consider how it keeps going and what is good and bad for it. All this is empirical stuff about particular items in the world, and you only get to the chemistry a bit later, don't you? You start asking what proteins are there and so on, and of course that can be extremely important. And I mean, if somebody's reductive in the sense that they say, but you must always get to the proteins, that's not the problem, that's not the offensive kind. It's the offensive kind is when they say it's the only thing, and that is what the Vienna Circle people said. They said that the whole of a science could be, and it couldn't. And I think, I don't know how they supported this story at all. But they were one more lot of people who were primarily interested in putting down the church. I mean, Vienna was ruled by the Catholic Church and they didn't like it. And I think they jumped very quickly from that thought to thinking what was needed. What was needed was the physical. And I mean, physical itself is a little bit ambiguous, I think. And we normally think of this table as being physical object or apples or whatever. But physics doesn't talk about tables or apples or, you know, physics talks in a much more abstract way. And what you might want to know about the table as a physical object has got to be put in the language of physics. It can't be table language, as it were. I think that this is a very common sort of self-deception among people who think they're materialists. You see, they think that if they're saying, well, that's all that exists, isn't it? You see, this is understandable, but they aren't, that isn't. Thank you. Yes. Oops. But you see, it was quite interesting. There's been a change in recent times, I think, among philosophers. They don't like to use the word materialist. They want to say physicalist instead. Now, of course, the word materialist is highly ambiguous. You can use it for just people who've got too much money or something. But the what's supposed to follow from talking about physicalists is that only what the science of physics tells them is real. So it wouldn't be true to say that tables are real, or wood, or apples, or anything like that. These are common sense categories. The language of physics is about atoms and electrons and black holes and similar, very limited set of words are available for you to be talking physics, and if you try to get into an argument about physics by saying, but the table's hard, isn't it, you will be off the point. This isn't the way they think thinking at all. Now, why did it sound a little bit persuasive to me, what you said?
I use the term molecular biology. It sounds quite clever.
Yes. Well, I mean, obviously, molecular biology applies to everything of a roughly material kind. But there is no set of roughly material objects of which you can say that the real truth about them is only you can't reach that except through an intermediate layer of all sorts of other concepts. It's the richness of the conceptual scheme that's getting lost, I think. And I think that the Vienna Circle must have been deceiving themselves about this. I don't know what they counted as being physics, but they can't have been noticing how much it really would have to cover.
Thank you. Will you continue? I'm worried that we're going to have people's questions unanswered. But if are there any more questions in the room awaiting? There's one right at the back. Are you able to walk that far?
I think I still can.
I'm managing to hear it, which rather surprises me. You've got this room's acoustics are good.
Thank you again, Professor Midgley. I'm sympathetic to your views on the problematic nature of materialism. And I'm aware of the fact that some materialists are put forward the idea that ideas are a form of matter and that everything is made of matter. But something seems to have gone wrong in the reasoning, because if everything is made of matter, how can one avoid being a materialist?
Well, the word matter would lose its meaning, would it not? I mean, the word matter exists exactly to make the contrast between your ideas and the stuff in your brain or something. I think that this sort of ambiguity is one thing that has caused philosophers lately to take up the word physicalist instead. But I'm saying this isn't going to do them much good, because the physics is so extremely abstract. It gets right away from the ordinary objects that we might be likely to discuss.
Right. So I know there's many more topics which we could go on to discuss after this very rich talk, but we have reached the end of our allotted slot. So I'd like to inform everyone here that the Ian Ramsey Centre for the Humane Philosophy Project have provided some wine and other refreshments at the back of the room. You're very welcome to stay here and to continue discussing these topics with us. I'd like to just thank once again all of the sponsors of these seminars, and in particular the University of Warsaw, for participating in this.
Yes, can I join in such with a great... that? Yes.
Maybe one more round of applause for the University of Warsaw. And finally, one more round of applause for our speaker today, Dr. Mary Midgley.